Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Legacy of Conquest, The Unbroken Past of the American West, by Patricia Nelson Limerick, PhD. Narrated by Pam Ward. Preface. This book, to start on a personal note, has made me happy. If we organized a nationwide scavenger hunt, and every participant rushed to the nearest university campus to find a professor who was discontented and even dismayed by the lack of attention paid to his or her publications, the race would be over as soon as the first scavenger hunter talked to the first professor. But the contestants would be well advised not to waste their time on me. There is a chance that I will spend my retirement in one of those glass-walled dioramas displayed at natural history museums. I will be placed in a replica of my cluttered study, and the wall caption will say, "Patty Limerick is the only known specimen of a university-based author who is entirely content with the visibility and impact of her published work. Sightings of other such creatures have been reported, but none have been verified by science." The existence of this book is no small miracle in itself. Few fuels for intellectual activity can match anger in its efficiency, duration, and renewability. So it was very lucky that 20 years ago, the author of The Legacy of Conquest operated with a tank filled with this fuel, and also found unlimited opportunities to keep the tank topped off. An abundant supply of peevishness helps to explain the astonishing fact that an author not known for her ability to meet deadlines wrote this book in a couple of years, and, just as miraculously, pushed perfectionist dreams aside and surrendered the manuscript to the publisher in a moderately timely fashion. By the early 1980s, I was convinced that Western American history was cheated of the respect and attention it deserved, and I had gotten it into my head that I could address and correct this situation. This was a fine idea, until I tried to put it into practice. Persuading readers to hold Western history in higher regard would require me to read widely in many fields, and then assemble these pieces and parts together into an overview of the whole territory. And this act of synthesis would require me to face and defy the demon known as scholarly specialization, a demon with a particular talent for eroding courage and draining the life force. Plus, I would have to court the wrath of my elders, and quite a few of my contemporaries, by making a claim for originality and fresh perspective. A challenge that a young, untenured, unpublished, thin-skinned female academic would have been well advised to duck. Doubts, second thoughts, and a recognition that I was in over my head periodically made me wish that I had had the sense to duck. But the project was saved by an abundance of occasions to get mad and fired up again. Consider a conversation from the mid-1980s when an ambitious and very status-conscious English professor was leaving the University of Colorado for a considerably more prestigious Southern university. "Now that I am moving to the South," he declared to a little group of us at a cocktail party, "I realize that I will have to do a lot of reading in Southern history and Southern literature." "When you moved to the West," I asked, "did you realize that you had to do a lot of reading in Western history and Western literature?" I thought I had asked a question that deserved an answer. My companions, including the professor bending low under his burden of weighty self-esteem, felt differently. To their ears, I had made a joke, since I could not possibly believe that a person of this man's intellectual caliber should invest his valuable time in reading Zane Grey, Louis L'Amour, and their historian equivalents, many of them based at podunk Western colleges. Southern history and literature were significant and prestigious. Western history and literature were lightweight and dismissible. Exchanges like this left me very crabby and very motivated. In these irritating conversations, I did not say, "I will show you." but that sentiment was front and center in my mind. When the demon of scholarly specialization came at me, pointing out that on every page of this book I was intruding on the turf of experts who knew these subjects far better than I could sternly tell the demon, "I cannot pay attention to you because there is something larger than my own fears at stake here." A powerful motivation had entered the picture. I had come to believe that the study of history could illuminate and improve public conversation and decision-making on controversial Western issues. This was urgent and important. The demon of specialization would just have to go find someone else to terrorize, and apparently he found no shortage of surrogates. That demon then handed off to the demon demanding linear argumentation, who fared even worse. Kind people have, over the years, asked the gentle, gracious, and sharply pointed question, "What exactly was your strategy for organizing this book?" The organizational strategy was a day spent on the floor in Boulder, Colorado in the summer of 1984. I took index cards, each bearing a favorite idea or story, and crawled around the floor, putting the cards in stacks. Big stacks became chapters. Smaller stacks went into boxes that eventually became hostages in the basement, where they still await rescue and redemption. The legacy of Conquest hit the streets in the summer of 1987. Western historians and the general reading public reached something close to perfect agreement in their initial response. They were underwhelmed. Attempting to raise my spirits, my wonderful but perhaps excessively frank editor, Ed Barber, as he contemplated a tepid review in the New York Times Book Review, reassured me with this memorable remark. "I think," he said, "that your next book will do much better with reviewers." It is, they say, always darkest before the dawn. And thank heavens this dawn came on fast. The legacy of Conquest came out of the shadows and insisted on its right to sit in the sun. In truth, at a certain point of national publicity and scholarly debate, sunscreen might have done the book some good. The book did, after all, have its lamentable flaws and omissions. It has been declared that Santa Fe, New Mexico, was the longest-lasting Hispanic settlement in the United States, an assertion that did little justice to St. Augustine. This would be one among several demonstrations that I was perhaps a little too intent on accenting the early activities of Europeans in what became the Trans-Mississippi West. I have never doubted or questioned the importance of the history of Eastern North America, but I also felt justified in putting everything I had into shifting the center of significance westward. A number of commentators pointed out that it was odd to find a book claiming to be an overview of Western history that did not use the words Alamo or Little Bighorn, surely the two biggest celebrity events for the region. In fact, Legacy made next to no reference to wars or battles. I had made the conscious choice to stay away from the topic of the Indian Wars, telling myself that there was no need to dwell on this unhappy subject, since the tribes who did not formally fight the U.S. Army ended up just as conquered as those who did. When I later had to write an essay on the Indian Wars, I was awake at 2 a.m. for several weeks, looking at the ceiling and brooding about man's and woman's inhumanity to men and women, as manifested in the enthusiasm for inflicting trauma and puncturing the skin of others. When Legacy was criticized for being too negative and too grim, the charges seemed decidedly exaggerated, since I had sidestepped and evaded the most disheartening stories in the region's past. The critique that most surprised and instructed me came from urban historians who pointed out the absence of a reckoning with the role of cities in the most urbanized of regions. Surely they are mistaken, I thought. Surely I didn't revert and regress to that tired old idea that the real West is the rural West. But, alas, my urban-oriented critics had me dead to rights. I had reverted to the idea that the real West meant the rural West. Of course, this slippage did deliver a benefit, sparing my readers the burden of watching me flounder over the question, to what degree are the West's cities and suburbs distinctly regional in character? On the contrary, doesn't it seem that the ostensible Westerners in these cities and suburbs actively defy their locale, planting and maintaining lawns, following imported architectural models, and generally offering themselves as embodied manifestations of the phrase plunked down, and refusing to respond to their setting? But whatever their degree of failure to achieve native and authentic Westernness, cities and towns are key elements of the region's story, and it is a puzzle to me why I paid so little attention to them. And hindsight also declares that it would have been smart to include the fur trade. When reviewers remarked on its absence, I accepted their point. The activities of trappers and traders had dramatically rearranged power and resources in the West before the miners, settlers, and ranchers showed up. And an overview of Western history should have remarked on that. But over time, I have realized that writing about the fur trade would have given me the chance to reconsider the overly sharp categories for human identity that I took for granted in Legacy. In this book, I use the terms of ethnicity, Anglo-American, Mexican-American, Indian, African-American, etc., as if I were dealing with characteristics and qualities that were clearly marked, settled, and lasting. In what may well be the biggest change in my thinking since 1987, I now recognize that every human being is a mixture of categories and classifications. We do one another a considerable disservice, complicating our social and political conflicts, when we try to impose a sort of one identity per customer limit on our fellow humans. The preferred academic term for this recognition is hybridity, decoded from academies. Hybridity offers a welcome invitation to put the ethnic categories we take for granted through a constant process of reappraisal, acknowledging how much they are matters of mixture and change. The fur trade would have given me a great way to put forward this proposition. The trappers and traders were men, but women played a central role in their business and in the society derived from that business. Many European or Euro-American men took up, in varying degrees of formal marriage, with Indian women. The first advantage in recognizing this reality of the fur trade is that the image of the utterly self-reliant, single male fur trappers and traders is instantly rectified, as these men regain their context in the domain of family and human connection. The second advantage is even greater. With the interaction between white men and Indian women, the fur trade occasioned a mixture of populations that blurred the boundaries between the categories Indian and white. In very similar ways, trade relations in the 1820s and 1830s led to intermarriage between white men and Mexican women in New Mexico and California. Of course, going even further back in time, the term mestizo recorded the mixture between Spanish and Indian peoples that lies at the foundation of Mexican identity. I could have done myself, Western historians, and Westerners a service by noting and incorporating this factor of hybridity, and thus loosening up the rigid and persistent categories that humans use to exaggerate their differences. Writing a preface to a new edition of a book approaching its 20th birthday allows some exercise of hindsight and even self-reproach. But my contentment with the impact of this book overrules much of that second-guessing. The legacy of conquest predicted a renaissance in the field of Western American history. The renaissance happened. Humans are generally quite a failure when it comes to prediction, and thus I count myself extremely lucky to have had a prophecy prove out. I also count myself very lucky to have had the privilege of serving as president of the Western History Association in 2000. The transition from rebellious young Turk to established old bird was a rapid and sometimes disorienting journey. But the honor of being WHA president made the arrival of middle age into a much more bearable development. Sometimes condemned for its glumness and emphasis on the sorrows of history, the legacy of conquest was actually a profoundly cheerful enterprise, full of optimism. I hoped the book would provide, so to speak, an over-the-counter remedy for the three big afflictions burdening the field. A focus on the westward movement of white men had obscured the fact that people converged on the American West from every starting point on the planet. The remedy was an easy one. Reallocate attention to minorities, Indian people, Mexicans and Mexican Americans, Asian Americans and African Americans, and pay attention to the difference between women's and men's experiences, whatever their ethnicity. Did I go too far in pushing white men to the margins of historical attention? I would be the first one now to say that the lives, actions, and beliefs of white men require our best thought, critical appraisal, and respect, which does nothing to lessen the historical significance of the so-called others. A misguided and widespread preoccupation with the end of the frontier in 1890 had broken Western history into two disconnected parts, the distinctive frontier West, sometimes known as the Old West or even the Wild West, and the homogeneous, just one part of the nation, West. Here, too, an antidote quickly offered itself. Recognize that the events of the 19th century shaped every dimension of Western life in the 20th, and now 21st century. And then put this reconnection to work in helping us understand our own times. The fuzzy and forgiving term frontier had drawn our attention from what westward expansion had meant to native people, as well as citizens of the Mexican North and to the natural environment. But a quick dose of honesty could cure this problem. Accept the applicability of the sharp and honest term conquest to the United States' westward expansion, and national self-understanding would be beneficially enhanced. Behind these diagnoses and prescriptions were two primary goals: to assert the value and vitality of the field of Western history by freeing it of tired and anachronistic habits of thought, and to present a more honest and revealing version of the past to public audiences, challenging the tyranny of academic jargon and specialization. The author of The Legacy of Conquest had quite a preoccupation with the historical pattern by which actions produced unintended and unexpected consequences. Thus, it was fitting, funny, and only occasionally maddening to see the book itself live up to its own theme, delivering unintended consequences promptly and mercilessly. The attempt to boot out the old orthodoxies almost instantly resulted in the installation of a new orthodoxy called the New Western History, which was pretty ironic in itself. But the second goal took a worse beating. In the years after the publication of Legacy, specialization and the habits of academic writers addressing an audience of other university-based specialists got a great boost. The revolution and I sometimes marched in separate directions, which is not an uncommon experience for revolutionary advocates. Legacy came out in 1987. The New Western History got christened in 1989, and in academic circles, the next 4 or 5 years could carry the label of the first crabby era. Some of the older, established Western historians were outraged by the challenges packed into Legacy, and they were unrestrained in sharing their outrage with colleagues and with reporters, emotionally defending their turf against the intruder. A few of them played a wonderful double-handed game, declaring first that the legacy of Conquest got it all wrong, and second, that there was nothing new in the book since they themselves had already said everything I had said years ago, and thus any credit for innovation should go to them. Happily, my sense of humor stayed robust and resilient, and I discovered a great personal enthusiasm for argument, debate, and adrenaline. In hindsight, it turns out that the era of my feistiness was also the era, by various measures and gauges, of the greatest pep in the field of Western history. Lots of public attention to the fight over the subject, the largest attendance at WHA meetings, a perception on the part of historians in other fields that the American West had come into its own as a vital field. And yet expressions of gratitude for the revival of the field were not free-flowing. The clash of egos and careerist ambitions seemed, for a spell, to have led to a goofy situation in which historians had upstaged the people of the Western past who were ostensibly the subjects of our attention. But the good news was that university-based Western historians could no longer qualify for listing as an endangered species. In the years since 1987, a cascade of innovative and important books and articles appeared and made the recovery of the field unmistakable. The bad news was that this burst of energy seemed more and more directed toward an academic audience. The jargon of cultural theory and postmodernism was one source of trouble. The customs of universities and colleges in evaluating and promoting young scholars on the basis of their publication record and the appraisal of their peers reinforced the predilection toward specialization and narrowness. After an intervening period of comparative goodwill, the second crabby era broke upon us in the early years of the 21st century, as a group of mid-career scholars expressed their dismay over the backwardness of the Western History Association and put heart and soul into the production and sustaining of an academic tempest in a teapot. Or so it looked to me, anyway. The publication of The Legacy of Conquest brought enormous change to my life. The biggest change was that I got to find out what that interesting term public intellectual means in practice. When Legacy appeared, I had been an inmate of universities for nearly 20 years. Legacy changed all that, providing me with ever-increasing opportunities to apply historical perspective to contemporary Western problems. In 1989, the very accomplished law professor Charles Wilkinson and I co-founded the Center of the American West at the University of Colorado. In 1995, I became the center's faculty director and chair of the board. At the center, we have made a point of respecting widely varying points of view on the West's social, political, economic, and cultural changes. We have hosted secretaries of the Interior, Stuart Udall and Gail Norton, James Watt and Bruce Babbitt. We have placed next to one another at dinner tables the advocates of snowmobiles and the enthusiasts for natural sound, the proponents for wolf introduction, and the livestock raisers who see wolves as enemies. Plunging right to the heart of one of the most heated issues of the day, we have served as shuttle diplomats and ambassadors between natural gas producers and environmentalists opposing development on public lands. The chances to practice applied history have been astonishingly gratifying and instructive. Even as this change in my professional life has put greater and greater distance between me and conventional academic life. And the distance is striking. In the early 21st century, public discussions in this nation operate with a more than sufficient supply of bitterness and friction. The forces for polarization are so fully staffed that, I finally concluded, polarization did not need my help. If I wanted to have a positive effect on public decision-making and the conduct of citizens and voters, then life as a public intellectual required me to put a lot less effort into contention and controversy and a lot more into forethought, self-restraint, tolerance, grace, and diplomacy. Outspoken and provocative statements are very fun to make. But I had given myself many opportunities to learn that the fun is rapidly followed by heavy labor in rebuilding bridges and making repairs. Effectiveness as a public intellectual, contrary to what I used to think and to what many academics still think, works best when you deny yourself the initial fun of unrestrained expression. Think strategically before speaking. Listen respectfully to your critics. And even, now and then, admit that they have persuaded you to change your thinking. Perhaps most disorienting for some who have puzzled over my change in methods, I reversed my conduct toward the Western myth. In countless showdowns and contests, the romanticized, commercialized myth of the West prevailed over my plucky challenges to it. After defeats beyond counting, a new strategy seemed in order. Why not try to co-opt the myth and enlist its endless energy for good causes? Moreover, why not even have fun with it? When I wrote Legacy, I doubt I owned a single item of Western wear. At the time of this writing, I am the owner of 5 pairs of cowboy boots, 2 excellent Stetsons, 1 white, 1 black, depending on the symbolic needs of the moment, 3 fringed jackets, 8 yoked Western shirts, 1 very beautiful bolo tie, and a couple of belts with magnificent buckles. While this is not exactly a circumstance on which the phrase, "even the devil can quote scripture," would have bearing, it is still evidence that even a famed one-time debunker of the Western myth can unleash her credit card in a Western wear store and, maybe, enlist the power of the myth in support of new causes. In 2005, I wrote a few essays as a guest columnist for the New York Times. The national public record appearance of the reconfigured, peacemaking, consensus-building Patty Limerick distressed and disturbed a number of readers. "You used to be a very good historian," wrote one disappointed soul. "What happened to that?" Answering that question might require a whole new book. In fact, the degree of change in my assumptions and practices may have been fairly modest. The last 2 sentences in Legacy can be read as foretelling my mild-mannered future. After listing the varied ethnicities and occupations of Westerners, I ended the book with this hopeful declaration. We share the same region and its history, but we wait to be introduced. The serious exploration of the historical process that made us neighbors provides that introduction. On February 1, 2005, Jeff Limerick, my beloved husband, whose encouragement, wisdom, calm perspective, perfect pitch in respect for his fellow humans, and independent mind made the writing of this book possible, died from a stroke. I am grateful every day for the legacy of valued memories he left me, and for the legacy of this plucky, persistent, funny, and hopeful book. The serious exploration of the historical process that made us neighbors has given me the chance to introduce myself to hundreds of Western neighbors, and their friendship has sustained me. Introduction: Closing the Frontier and Opening Western History. Each age writes the history of the past anew, with reference to the conditions uppermost in its own time. The aim of history, then, is to know the elements of the present by understanding what came into the present from the past. For the present is simply the developing past, the past, the undeveloped present. The antiquarian strives to bring back the past for the sake of the past. The historian strives to show the present to itself by revealing its origin from the past. The goal of the antiquarian is the dead past. The goal of the historian is the living present. Frederick Jackson Turner, 1891. In 1883, Nannie Alderson married, left her home in Virginia, and traveled to her new life on a ranch in Montana. Reminiscing about those years, Mrs. Alderson noted a particular feature of Montana cuisine and landscape. "Everyone in the country lived out of cans," she said, "and you would see a great heap of them outside every little shack." Hollywood did not commemorate these heaps in Western movies. And yet, by the common wisdom of archaeologists, trash heaps say a great deal about their creators. Living out of cans, the Montana ranchers were typical Westerners, celebrating independence while relying on a vital connection to the outside world. More important, the cans represented continuity, simply by staying in place. The garbage collector never came, and the evidence of last week's, last year's, meals stayed in sight. When Western historians yielded to a preoccupation with the frontier and its supposed end, past and present fell apart, divided by the watershed of 1890. But Western reality followed other patterns. Matter, issues, memories, and dilemmas were all conserved. In the mountains of Colorado, miners dug shafts, worked mines, and then gave them up. The miners left, their works remain. One walks with some caution in these historic regions. Land that appears solid may be honeycombed, and one would not like to plunge unexpectedly into the legacy of Western history. The conquest of Western America shapes the present as dramatically, and sometimes as perilously, as the old mines shape the mountainsides. To live with that legacy, contemporary Americans ought to be well-informed and well-warned about the connections between past and present. But here, the peculiar status of Western American history has posed an obstacle to understanding. Americans are left to stumble over, and sometimes into, those connections, caught off guard by the continued vitality of issues widely believed to be dead. Like slavery, conquest tested the ideals of the United States. Conquest deeply affected both the conqueror and the conquered, just as slavery shaped slaveholder and slave. Both historical experiences left deep imprints on particular regions and on the nation at large. The legacy of slavery and the legacy of conquest endure, shaping events into our own time. Here, however, we reach a principal difference. To most 20th century Americans, the legacy of slavery was serious business, while the legacy of conquest was not. Southern historians successfully fought through the aura of moonlight and magnolias and established slavery, emancipation, and black-white relations as major issues in American history. The Civil War, Reconstruction, the migration of Southern blacks into other regions, and the Civil Rights Movement all guaranteed that the nation would recognize the significance of slavery and the South. Conquest took another route into national memory. In the popular imagination, the reality of conquest dissolved into stereotypes of noble savages and noble pioneers struggling quaintly in the wilderness. These adventures seemed to have no bearing on the complex realities of 20th century America. In Western paintings, novels, movies, and television shows, those stereotypes were valued precisely because they offered an escape from modern troubles. The subject of slavery was the domain of serious scholars and the occasion for sober national reflection. The subject of conquest was the domain of mass entertainment and the occasion for lighthearted national escapism. An element of regret for what we did to the Indians had entered the picture, but the dominant feature of conquest remained adventure. Children happily played cowboys and Indians, but stopped short of masters and slaves. When the history of conquest lost solidity, the history of an entire region suffered the same loss. Just as black-white relations and slavery were particularly associated with the South, so conquest was particularly associated with the West. Of course, the entire New World had been conquered. The West was hardly unique in this regard. But if the American West was mentioned to an American, or perhaps even more to a European, frontier wars and pioneering came immediately to mind. For various reasons, the West acquired an identity as the focal point of conquest. In that character, the West enjoyed its few moments of celebrity in mainstream American history as the necessary stage setting for the last big sweep of national expansionism. But when conquest reached the Pacific and filled in the areas in between, attention returned eastward. Historical significance had been a tourist visiting the West for the peak of adventure and heading home when the action slowed down. Professional historians of the American West thus became a people locked in an identity crisis, given to brooding about their place in the profession. Reasons for brooding appeared in a variety of forms: the failure of universities to replace older Western historians when they retired, the reluctance of East Coast publishers and reviewers to pay attention to Western history, the occasional remarks revealing that well-established American historians did not have much respect for the field. In 1984, at a conference on American Indian history, I sat in the audience and heard one colonial historian confirm the Western historian's worst fears. Yet, how important is the West, minus California and urban population clusters in the Pacific Northwest, in the 20th century, or even in the 19th century? For, in our role as scholars, we must recognize that the subject of westward expansion itself no longer engages the attention of many, perhaps most, historians of the United States. Surveys of college and university curricula indicate a steady decline in courses dealing with history of the West. Significant numbers of graduate students no longer write dissertations on this subject, and few of the leading members of our profession have achieved their scholarly reputations in this field. What had happened to Western history? Paradoxically, the problem stemmed from the excess of respect given to the idea of the field's founder, Frederick Jackson Turner. Ideas presented in Turner's famous 1893 address, The Significance of the Frontier in American History. Turner was a scholar with intellectual courage, an innovative spirit, and a forceful writing style. But respect for the individual flowed over into excessive deference to the individual's ideas. To many historians, the Turner thesis was Western history. If something had gone wrong with the thesis, something had gone wrong with Western history. The center of American history, Turner had argued, was actually to be found at its edges. As the American people proceeded westward, the frontier was the outer edge of the wave, the meeting point between savagery and civilization, and the line of most effective and rapid Americanization. The struggle with the wilderness turned Europeans into Americans, a process Turner made the central story of American history. The existence of an area of free land, its continuous recession, and the advance of American settlement westward explain American development. But American development came to an unsettling close when the 1890 census revealed that no vast tracts of land remained for American conquest. And now, Turner noted at the conclusion of his essay, 4 centuries from the discovery of America, at the end of 100 years of life under the Constitution, the frontier has gone, and with its going has closed the first period of American history. Turner, in 1893, seemed to have the field of Western American history fully corralled, unified under the concept frontier. Exploration, Fur trade, overland travel, farming, mining, town founding, merchandising, grazing, logging, the diverse activities in the 19th century West were all supposed to fit into the category. In fact, the apparently unifying concept of the frontier had arbitrary limits that excluded more than they contained. Turner was, to put it mildly, ethnocentric and nationalistic. English-speaking white men were the stars of his story. Indians, Hispanics, French Canadians, and Asians were at best supporting actors, and at worst, invisible. Nearly as invisible were women of all ethnicities. Turner was also primarily concerned with agrarian settlement and folk democracy in the comparatively well-watered Midwest. Deserts, mountains, mines, towns, cities, railroads, territorial government, and the institutions of commerce and finance never found much of a home in his model. Like many historians, Turner was interpreting the past in light of recent events. This presentism had great benefits and also great risks. History was bound to go on. Any definitive statement on the meaning of the West offered in 1893 would soon show its age. On this count, many of Turner's protégés did him a disservice. Their respect for him left the 1893 thesis set in stone. Turner himself moved on. In his later essays and his courses, he kept adding more history as it accumulated, noting, for instance, the Western oil boom that occurred after 1890, and yet showed many frontier-like characteristics. But while Turner moved on, the Turner thesis kept its 1893 form. By definition, the 20th century West fell outside the 1893 model. The frontier thesis, Howard Lamar wrote in 1968, implied that a discontinuity existed between America's rural past and its urban industrial present. Stressing discontinuity and the end of the first period of American history, the thesis was, by its own admission, Lamar pointed out, useless as a guide for the present and future. The rigidity of the Turner thesis left it particularly vulnerable to a great expansion of scholarship, accelerating in the 1960s and afterward. Individual historians simply set aside the thesis and studied particular Western places, people, and events. The diversity and complexity those studies revealed, especially in the history of the West's minorities, some of whom were, in earlier phases, majorities, represented an intellectual revolution. Few of the findings fit the Turnerian conceptual model. Thus, a central irony, the very vitality of Western research, by exploding the model, made mainstream historians declare that the field was dead. Teachers often encountered the problem in the classroom. If they tried to keep up with the field, read new books and articles, and synthesize those findings for the students, they had no clear way to organize the course. The old Turnerian model of Anglo-Americans purposefully moving westward provided no help. The new Indian history alone rendered old course outlines untenable. The recognition of tribal diversity and of the active role Indians played in shaping history made for a much richer story, but also for one without a simple chronological shape. The breakdown of the old organizing idea fostered chaos. The corral built to contain Western history had been knocked apart. Conceptual change in Western history occurred slowly. The Turner corral served a variety of functions. Since Turner had given the American frontier national significance, abandoning him threatened the West's place in the mainstream of American history. The Turner concept also was tidy. In identifying an 1890 watershed, Turner labored to create what colonial historians and Southern historians got without effort. The American Revolution periodized colonial history. The Civil War and emancipation periodized Southern history. Both events provided writers of history with graceful ways to begin and end. Historians proceed with a safe conviction that 1776 and 1865 were real watersheds. Western historians had good reason to envy that windfall. The fact remained, the West never went to war for its independence. There is, of course, plenty of revolutionary rhetoric, complaints of exploitation and colonialism, comparisons of the Department of the Interior to the ministers of George III, laments over autonomy lost to meddling bureaucrats. But no confederation of Western states, no war for independence, and thus no watershed comparable to the Revolution or the Civil War. Left without a major turning point, Western historians had to create one. The opening and closing of the frontier were set up like flags marking the start and finish of a racecourse to give the West its significant chronology. There was no conceptual problem in getting the frontier opened with the arrival of white people in territory new to them or with the discovery of unexploited resources. The problem came at the other end. There is simply no definition of the closing of the frontier that is anything but arbitrary and riddled with exceptions and qualifications. What did Turner and the director of the census mean by the end of the frontier? Population in the West, Harold Simonson wrote, had reached the figure of at least two persons per square mile, the basis for calling an area settled. This is an odd definition. If the population density is the measure of a frontier condition, then the existence of a city, a town, or even a small mining camp closes the frontier for that site. One could easily argue the opposite, that a sudden concentration of population marks the opening stage, and that a population lowered through, for instance, the departure of people from a used-up mining region marks the end of the frontier and its opportunities. Hinging his definition on population density, Turner referred to the fact that most of the frontier had been transformed into individually owned property. And yet, in the far west of 1890, one half of the land remained federal property. On a solely agrarian frontier, Turner's definition might make some sense. One could say that when every arable acre was privately owned, if not yet in cultivation, the frontier had closed. In mining or grazing, though, use was never dependent on conventional ownership. Mineral claims on federal lands tended to be transitory, subsurface rights often being detached from surface ownership. Similarly, nerve, enterprise, and finally leasing, not ownership, determined grazing rights on the public domain. Regardless of the percentage of land in private ownership, opportunity in the discovery and development of natural resources reached no clear terminus. If the frontier ended in 1890, what was going on when prospectors and miners rushed to the southern Nevada mining discoveries in 1900? What of the expansion of irrigated farming following the passage of the Newlands Reclamation Act in 1902? How does one dismiss the 1901 Spindletop Gusher and the boom in Western oil, irregular but persistent through the century? How can one discount the uranium rushes of the late 1940s and 1950s? Are Geiger counters and airplanes less frontier-like than picks and shovels? The effort to exclude 20th-century events from the category frontier immersed the Western historian in conceptual fog. Hinging the admissions requirement on simple technology seemed arbitrary. Frontiers involve mules, horses, and oxen, but not jeeps. Pickaxes and pans, but not air drills and drag lines. Provisions in sacks and tins, but not in freeze-dried packets. Horse-drawn plows, but not mechanized combines with air-conditioned driver's modules, Bows and arrows, but certainly not nuclear tests in Nevada. Amateurs, but not engineers. This is, at base, a judgment of sentiment and nostalgia, in favor of tools controllable by one person, and supposedly closer to nature, and against the intrusion of modern machinery. The distinction says a great deal about the emotions of historians, but little about Western history. A frequent, less sentimental strategy for frontier definition involves a focus on symbolic events. This is an intellectually stimulating exercise, but it serves only to accent the intractable diversity of Western events. For this exercise, one selects first a defining characteristic of the frontier, and then an associated event. If contiguous territorial acquisition is the key process, 1848 and the acquisition of Oregon and the Mexican territories, or alternatively the Gadsden Purchase in 1854, mark the end of the frontier. If individual opportunity is preeminent, the Comstock load in the 1860s stands out, signaling the consolidation of industrial underground mining and the shift in aspiration from windfalls to wages. If the workability of the West as a refuge for distinctive societies is deemed essential, the 1890 Mormon concession on polygamy signals the closing. If unrestricted use of the public domain is crucial, the frontier ended in 1934 with the Taylor Grazing Act and the leasing of grazing rights on the public lands. If political dependence in the form of territorial organization is the representative factor, the frontier ended in 1912 with the admission of New Mexico and Arizona to statehood. Or, if one includes the non-contiguous territory, in 1959 with the admission of Alaska. My own preferred entry in the closing competition is the popularization of tourism and the quaintness of the folk. When Indian war dances became tourist spectacles, when the formerly scorned customs of the Chinese drew tourists to Chinatown, when former outgroups found that characteristics that had once earned them disapproval could now earn them a living, when fearful, life-threatening deserts became charming patterns of color and light, the war was over, and the frontier could be considered closed, even museumized. My nomination has a problem, too. It does not come with clear divisions in time. Let the car break down in the desert, or let the Indians file a lawsuit to reassert an old land claim, and the quaint appeal of nature and native can abruptly vanish. The frontier is suddenly reopened. Frontier, then, is an unsubtle concept in a subtle world. Even so, the idea of the frontier is obviously worth studying as a historical artifact. The idea played an enormous role in national behavior, but so did the ideas of savagery and civilization, concepts that are currently not well respected as analytic terms. I certainly do not discount the power of the concept frontier in American history. My point is that the historian is obligated to understand how people saw their own times, but not obligated to adopt their terminology and point of view. That one may study how Westerners depended on the Colt repeating revolver is not an argument for using a gun in professional debate. If we give up a preoccupation with the frontier and look instead at the continuous sweep of Western American history, new organizing ideas await our attention, but no simple unitary model. Turner's frontier rested on a single point of view. It required that the observer stand in the east and look to the west. Now, like many scholars in other fields, Western historians have had to learn to live with relativism. A de-emphasis of the frontier opens the door to a different kind of intellectual stability. Turner's frontier was a process, not a place. When civilization had conquered savagery at any one location, the process and the historian's attention moved on. In rethinking Western history, we gain the freedom to think of the West as a place, as many complicated environments occupied by natives who considered their homelands to be the center, not the edge. In choosing to stress place more than process, we cannot fix exact boundaries for the region, any more than we can draw precise lines around the South, the Midwest, or that most elusive of regions, the East. Allowing for a certain shifting of borders, the West in this book will generally mean the present-day states of California, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Utah, Nevada, Arizona, New Mexico, Colorado, Kansas, Nebraska, Oklahoma, Texas, Montana, Wyoming, North Dakota, and South Dakota, and more changeably, Iowa, Missouri, Arkansas, and Louisiana. Many patterns explored here apply also to Alaska, but limits of space and time have prohibited its full inclusion. This certainly makes for a complicated package, but the West, as place, has a compensatory, down-to-earth clarity that the migratory, abstract frontier could never have. Reorganized, the history of the West is a study of a place undergoing conquest and never fully escaping its consequences. In these terms, it has distinctive features as well as features it shares with the histories of other parts of the nation and the planet. Under the Turner thesis, Western history stood alone. An exciting trend in modern scholarship leads toward comparative history, toward Western American history as one chapter in the global story of Europe's expansion. Studies in comparative conquests promise to help knit the fragmented history of the planet back together. Western American history can be a prime contributor to that endeavor. De-emphasize the frontier and its supposed end. Conceive of the West as a place and not a process. And Western American history has a new look. First, the American West was an important meeting ground, the point where Indian America, Latin America, Anglo-America, Afro-America, and Asia intersected. In race relations, the West could make the turn-of-the-century northeastern urban confrontation between European immigrants and American nativists look like a family reunion. Similarly, in the diversity of languages, religions, and cultures, it surpassed the South. Second, the workings of conquest tied these diverse groups into the same story. Happily or not, minorities and majorities occupied a common ground. Conquest basically involved the drawing of lines on a map, the definition and allocation of ownership, personal, tribal, corporate, state, federal, and international, and the evolution of land from matter to property. The process had two stages, the initial drawing of the lines, which we have usually called the frontier stage, and the subsequent giving of meaning and power to those lines, which is still underway. Race relations paralleled the distribution of property, the application of labor and capital to make the property productive, and the allocation of profit. Western history has been an ongoing competition for legitimacy, for the right to claim for oneself and sometimes for one's group, the status of legitimate beneficiary of Western resources. This intersection of ethnic diversity with property allocation unifies Western history. The contest for property and profit has been accompanied by a contest for cultural dominance. Conquest also involved a struggle over languages, cultures, and religions. The pursuit of legitimacy and property overlapped with the pursuit of legitimacy in way of life and point of view. In a variety of matters, but especially in the unsettled questions of Indian assimilation and in the disputes over bilingualism and immigration in the still semi-Hispanic Southwest, this contest for cultural dominance remains a primary unresolved issue of conquest. Reconceived as a running story, A fragmented and discontinuous past becomes whole again. With its continuity restored, Western American history carries considerable significance for American history as a whole. Conquest forms the historical bedrock of the whole nation, and the American West is a preeminent case study in conquest and its consequences. Conquest was a literal, territorial form of economic growth. Westward expansion was the most concrete, down-to-earth demonstration of the economic habit on which the entire nation became dependent. If it is difficult for Americans to imagine that an economy might be stable and also healthy, many of the forces that fostered that attitude can be traced to the Western side of American history. Cultural pluralism and responses to race form primary issues in American social relations, and the American West, with its diversity of Indian tribes, Hispanics, Euro-Americans of every variety, and blacks, was a crucial case study in American race relations. The involvement of the federal government in the economy and the resulting dependence, resentment, and deficit have become major issues in American history and in contemporary politics. And the American West was the arena in which an expanded role for the federal government first took hold. Cycles of prosperity and recession have long characterized the American economy, and in that long-running game of crack the whip, the West has been at the far end of the whip, providing the prime example of the boom-bust instability of capitalism. The encounter of innocence with complexity is a recurrent theme in American culture, and Western history may well be the most dramatic and sustained case of high expectations and naivete meeting a frustrating and intractable reality. Many American people have held to a strong faith that humans can master the world, of nature and of humans around them, and Western America put that faith to one of its most revealing tests. A belief in progress has been a driving force in the modern world. As a depository of enormous hopes for progress, the American West may well be the best place in which to observe the complex and contradictory outcome of that faith. Beyond its national role, Western America has its own regional significance. Remoteness from both New York and Washington, D.C., the presence of most of the nation's Indian reservations, proximity to Mexico, ports opening to the Pacific Basin and Asia, dependence on natural resource extraction, the undergoing of conquest at a time when the American nation was both fully formed and fully self-conscious, the association of the region with a potent and persistent variety of nationalistic myth, the aridity of many areas, all these factors give Western America its own intrinsic historical significance. In this book, I have undertaken to pull the pieces together, to combine two or three decades of thriving scholarship with a decade of thriving journalism in Western American subjects. Much of the most interesting work in Western history has been done by individuals who consider themselves first and foremost urban, social, business, labor, Chicano, Indian, or environmental historians, not Western historians. Work in these specialties has prospered, but efforts at a regional synthesis have lagged behind. In the same way, journalists and historians often labor in separate spheres, unaware of the themes that unite their work. Their findings fit together to form a revived version of Western history, and this book is therefore an interpretation and a synthesis, not a monograph, and not a survey or summary. This book has taught me why historians might flee the challenge of synthesis. The genre breeds two alternating fears, that one is only echoing platitudes, and that one has gone out on a limb. The second fear has at least a kind of exhilaration. I am sometimes fully convinced that life out on a limb is the only life worth living. Everything I have written here, I believe. But because the field is vital and changing, I anticipate new developments every week. If Western history continues to thrive, I will look back at certain passages and shudder at my short-sightedness. Despite those moments of exhilaration, and because this book, by definition, relies on secondary sources, I am saying some familiar things. Earl Pomeroy has long stressed continuity in Western history and downplayed the frontier. In an essay published in 1959, John Cohague carefully explored the distinction between the West as frontier and the West as place or region. My own advisor, Howard Lamar, has long studied the 20th century West. Why repeat their arguments? Because the message has not gotten through. The public holds to the idea of a great discontinuity between the frontier and the Western present. Even in universities, the old perceptions of Western history seem to thrive. Young scholars hired to teach Western American history learn that their departments expect their courses to end in 1890. My own courses in Western history at the University of Colorado carry the title The Early American Frontier and The Later American Frontier. While I postpone the labor of going to the Committee on Courses to explain how the field has changed and why a new title is in order. Others then have said much of what I say in this book. Nonetheless, the importance of the message and a widespread reluctance to receive it justify the deployment of many messengers. Just as Turner did, I take my cues from the present. I am thus sure to be overtaken by unplanned obsolescence. A presentist view seems to me, as it did to Turner, worth the risk. In the second half of the 20th century, every major issue from frontier history reappeared in the courts or in Congress. Struggles over Indian resources and tribal autonomy, troubled relations with Mexico, controversy over the origins of Mormonism, conflicts over water allocation, another farm crisis, a drastic swing downward in the boom-bust cycles of oil, copper, and timber, continued heavy migration to some parts of the West, with all the familiar problems of adjusting to growth and sorting out power between natives and newcomers, disputes over the use of the public lands, a determined retreat on federal spending in the West. All these issues were back on the streets and looking for trouble. Historians of the future will find meanings in these events beyond my imagination, but I firmly believe they will find the 1980s to be a key period in Western American history. If the federal government implements the Reagan policy of reversing the historical pattern of using federal money to stabilize Western economies, historians will see the 1980s as a watershed decade. In countless ways, events in the 1980s suggest a need to reevaluate Western history. Consider the case study offered by Louis L'Amour, author of 88 books about life on the American frontier, as of March 1984. L'Amour is the mid-20th century's successor to Zane Grey, a writer still intoxicated with the independence, nobility, grandeur, and adventure of the frontier. He remains true to the plot formula of tough men in the tough land. A century ago, L'Amour wrote in a commentary in 1984, the Western Plains were overrun by buffalo, and many a tear has been shed over their passing. But where they grazed, we now raise grain to feed a large part of the world. This process of progress through conquest reached no terminus. We are a people born to the frontier, and it has not passed away. Our move into space has opened the greatest frontier of all, the frontier that has no end. But only a year later, in 1985, circumstances disclosed a different Louis L'Amour. Louis L'Amour's Real Life Showdown, the headline in the Denver Post read, Western author, Colorado Ute, duel over proposed power line. Lemoore's idyllic ranch in southwest Colorado faced the threat of a 345,000-volt power line, which would frame his view of the mountains with cables and towering support poles, and which might also trigger health problems, ranging from headaches and fatigue to birth defects and cancer. Lemoore fought back with a conventional Western American weapon. The lawsuit, not the six-gun. If Lemoore recognized the irony in his situation, he did not share it with reporters. The processes of Western development do run continuously from past to present, from mining, cattle raising, and farming, on to hydroelectric power and even into space. The power line is a logical outcome of the process of development Lemoore's novels celebrate. But in this particular case, the author was facing the costs of development, of conquest, and not simply cheering for the benefits. "People never worry about these things until it's too late," Lemoore said of the power line in 1985. 88 books later, he was at last hot on the trail of the meanings of Western history. Part 1. The Conquerors. Chapter 1. Empire of Innocence. When academic territories were parceled out in the early 20th century, anthropology got the tellers of tales, and history got the keepers of written records. As anthropology and history diverged, human differences that hinged on literacy assumed an undeserved significance. Working with oral, pre-industrial, pre-state societies, anthropologists acknowledged the power of culture and of a received worldview. They knew that the folk conception of the world was not narrowly tied to proof and evidence. But with the disciplinary boundary overdrawn, it was easy for historians to assume that literacy, the modern state, and the commercial world had produced a different sort of creature entirely. Humans less inclined to put myth over reality, more inclined to measure their beliefs by the standard of accuracy and practicality. When anthropology and history moved closer together, so did their subjects of inquiry. Tribal people or nationalists, tellers of stories or keepers of account books, humans live in a world in which mental reality does not have to submit to narrow tests of accuracy. To analyze how white Americans thought about the West, it helps to think anthropologically. One lesson of anthropology is the extraordinary power of cultural persistence. With American Indians, for instance, beliefs and values will persist even when the supporting economic and political structures have vanished. What holds for Indians holds as well for white Americans. The values they attached to westward expansion persist, in cheerful defiance of contrary evidence. Among those persistent values, few have more power than the idea of innocence. The dominant motive for moving west was improvement and opportunity, not injury to others. Few white Americans went west intending to ruin the natives and despoil the continent. Even when they were trespassers, Western Americans were hardly, in their own eyes, criminals. Rather, they were pioneers. The ends abundantly justified the means. Personal interest in the acquisition of property coincided with national interest in the acquisition of territory, and those interests overlapped, in turn, with the mission to extend the domain of Christian civilization. Innocence of intention placed the course of events in a bright and positive light. Only over time would the shadows compete for our attention. One might expect John Wesley Hardin, the Texan mass murderer and outlaw, to forswear the role of innocent. But this is an assumption to be made with caution in Western history. Hardin was, after all, of innocent stock, the son of a preacher who named his son John Wesley after the founder of Methodism. In prison, a recent editor of Hardin's autobiography notes, Hardin read the Bible and many books on theology. There he was appointed superintendent of the Sunday schools. If one read Hardin's autobiography with no knowledge of the author's later career, one might mistake the tone for that of a model citizen and pillar of the community. "Our parents taught us from infancy to be honest, truthful, and brave," he said, going on to provide further evidence of his good character. "I always tried to excel in my studies, and generally stood at the head. And if that was not enough, I was always a very child of nature, and her ways and moods were my study." To be sure, Hardin fought a lot, but this was consonant with parental instructions that honor and the willingness to defend that honor came in the same package. When he was 15, he shot and killed a black man. This was, to Hardin's mind, not a loss of innocence, but a defense of it. The Negro, he said, had tried to bully him. The year was 1868, and Texas was at the mercy of post-war Reconstruction. Bullied by Yankee soldiers, carpetbaggers and bureau agents, blacks and renegades, all of them inveterate enemies of the South. "And so," Hardin said, "unwillingly I became a fugitive, not from justice, be it known, but from the injustice and misrule of the people who had subjugated the South." Hardin did go on to kill 20 or more men, but he appears never to have wavered from his chosen role, the gunfighter as Western injured innocent with a strong Southern accent. The idea of the innocent victim retains extraordinary power, and no situation made a stronger symbolic statement of this than that of the white woman murdered by Indians. Here was surely a clear case of victimization, villainy, and betrayed innocence. But few deaths of this kind occurred in American history with such purity. They were, instead, embedded in the complex dynamics of race relations, in which neither concept, villain or victim, did much to illuminate history. Narcissa Prentice Whitman made a very unlikely villain. Deeply moved by the thought of Western Indians living without knowledge of Christianity, Narcissa Prentice wrote her mission board in 1835, "I now offer myself to the American board to be employed in their service among the heathen." In 1836, she left her home in New York to rescue the Indians in Oregon. An unattached female could hardly be a missionary, and before her departure, Narcissa Prentice hastily married another Oregon volunteer, Marcus Whitman. The Whitmans and Henry and Eliza Spaulding set off to cross the country. Pioneers on the Overland Trail, they faced stiff challenges from nature and some from human nature. The fur trappers and traders with whom they traveled resented the delays and sermons that came with missionary companionship. The missionaries themselves presented less than a united front. They had the strong, contentious personalities of self-appointed agents of God. They also had a history. Henry Spaulding had courted Narcissa and lost. Anyone who thinks of the 19th century West as a land of fresh starts and new beginnings might think of Henry Spaulding and Narcissa Whitman and the memories they took with them to Oregon. Arriving in the Oregon country, the missionaries, like salesmen dividing up markets, divided up tribes and locations. The Whitmans set to work on the Cayuse Indians. Narcissa Whitman's life in Oregon provides little support for the image of life in the West as free, adventurous, and romantic. Most of the time she labored. She had one child of her own. She adopted many others, mixed-blood children of fur trappers and orphans from the Overland Trail. "My health has been so poor," she wrote her sister in 1846, "and my family has increased so rapidly that it has been impossible. You will be astonished to know that we have 11 children in our family, and not one of them our own by birth. But so it is. 7 orphans were brought to our door in October 1844, whose parents both died on the way to this country. Destitute and friendless, there was no other alternative. We must take them in or they must perish." Depending on one's point of view, the Whitman Mission had a lucky or an unlucky location. along the Oregon Trail, where exhausted travelers arrived, desperate for food, rest, and help. Narcissa Whitman's small home served as kitchen, dining hall, dormitory, and church building, while she longed for privacy and rest. She often cooked 3 meals a day for 20 people. For 5 years, she had no stove and cooked in an open fireplace. In the midst of crowds, she was lonely, writing nostalgic letters to friends and family in the East, who seemed to answer infrequently. She went as long as 2 years without a letter from home. Separated by distance, and sometimes by quarrels, Narcissa and the other missionary wives in Oregon tried for a time to organize a 19th-century version of a woman's support group. At a certain hour every day, they would pause in their work, think of each other, and pray for the strength to be proper mothers to their children in the wilderness. Direct tragedy added to loneliness, overwork, and frustration. The Whitman's only child, 2 years old, drowned while playing alone near a stream. Providence was testing Narcissa Whitman's faith in every imaginable way. Then, in November of 1847, after 11 years with the missionaries among them, when the white or mixed-blood mission population had grown to 20 men, 10 women, and 44 children, the Cayuse Indians rose in rebellion and killed 14 people, including Marcus and Narcissa Whitman. Was Narcissa Whitman an innocent victim of brutality and ingratitude? What possessed the Cayuses? One skill essential to the writing of Western American history is a capacity to deal with multiple points of view. It is as if one were a lawyer at a trial designed on the principle of the Mad Hatter's Tea Party. As soon as one begins to understand and empathize with the plaintiff's case, it is time to move over and empathize with the defendant. Seldom are there only two parties, or only two points of view. Taking into account division within groups, intertribal conflict, and factions within tribes, and in Oregon, settlers against missionaries, Protestants against Catholics, British Hudson's Bay Company traders against Americans, it is taxing simply to keep track of the points of view. Why did the Cayuses kill the Whitmans? The chain of events bringing the Whitmans to the Northwest was an odd and arbitrary one. In a recent book, the historian Christopher Miller explains that the Whitman mission was hardly the first crisis to hit the Columbia Plateau and its natives. A 300-year cold spell, a result of the Little Ice Age, had shaken the environment, apparently reducing food sources. Moreover, the effects of European presence in North America began reaching the plateau even before the Europeans themselves arrived. The conjunction of sickness, with the coming of horses, guns, climatic deterioration, and near-constant war, added up to an 18th-century crisis, punctuated by a disturbing and perplexing ashfall from a volcanic explosion. The changes brought many of the Plateau Indians to the conviction that the world was in trouble. They were thus receptive to a new set of prophecies from religious leaders. A central element of this new worldview came in the reported words of the man known as the Spokane Prophet, words spoken around 1790. "Soon there will come from the rising sun a different kind of man from any you have yet seen, who will bring with him a book and will teach you everything. After that, the world will fall to pieces," opening the way to a restored and better world. Groups of Indians therefore began to welcome whites, since learning from these newcomers was to be an essential stage in the route to a new future. In 1831, a small party of Nez Perce and Flathead Indians journeyed to St. Louis, Missouri. For years, Western historians said that these Indians had heard of Jesuits through contacts with fur traders and had come to ask for their own black robes. That confident claim aside, Christopher Miller has recently written that it is still a mystery how it all came to pass. Nonetheless, He argues persuasively that the Northwest Indians went to St. Louis pursuing religious fulfillment, according to the Plateau millennial tradition. It was their unlikely fate to be misunderstood by the equally millennial Christians who heard the story of the visit. A Protestant man named William Walker wrote a letter about the meetings in St. Louis, and the letter was circulated in church newspapers and read at church meetings, leaving the impression that the Indians of Oregon were begging for Christianity. And so, in this chain of circumstances, so bizarre as to seem providential, in Miller's words, the Cayuses got the Whitmans, who had responded to the furor provoked by the letter. Irritations began to pile up. The Whitmans set out to transform the Cayuses from hunters, fishers, and gatherers to farmers, from heathens to Presbyterians. As the place became a way station for the Oregon Trail, the mission began to look like an agency for the service of white people. This was not, in fact, too far from the founder's view of his organization. "It does not concern me so much what is to become of any particular set of Indians," Marcus Whitman wrote to his parents, "as to give them the offer of salvation through the gospel and the opportunity of civilization. I have no doubt our greatest work is to be to aid the white settlement of this country and help to found its religious institutions." The Cayuses began to suffer from white people's diseases, to which they had no immunity. Finally, in 1847, they were devastated by measles. While the white people at the mission seldom died from measles, the Indians noticed that an infected Cayuse nearly always died. It was an Indian conviction that disease was the result of either malevolence or spiritual transgression. Either way, the evidence pointed at the missionaries. When the Cayuses finally turned on the Whitmans, they were giving up the shared prophetic vision that these newcomers would teach a lesson essential to reshaping the world. The Cayuses were, in other words, acting in and responding to currents of history of which Narcissa Whitman was not a primary determinant. Descending on the Cayuses, determined to bring light to the benighted ones living in the thick darkness of heathenism, Narcissa Whitman was an intolerant invader. If she was not a villain, neither was she an innocent victim. Her story is melancholy, but on the whole, predictable, one of many similar stories in Western history that trigger an interventionist's urge. "Watch out, Narcissa," one finds oneself thinking, 140 years too late. "You think you are doing good works, but you are getting yourself and others into deep trouble." Given the inability of Cayuses to understand Presbyterians, and the inability of Presbyterians to understand Cayuses, the trouble could only escalate. Narcissa Whitman would not have imagined that there was anything to understand. Where the Cayuses had religion, social networks, a thriving trade in horses, and a full culture, Whitman would have seen vacancy, or worse, heathenism. Narcissa Whitman knew she was volunteering for risk. Her willingness to take on these risks is, however, easier to understand because it was based on religion. Irrational faith is its own explanation. One can analyze its components, but the fact remains that extraordinary faith leads to extraordinary action. The mystery is not that Narcissa Whitman risked all for the demands of the deity, but that so many others risked all for the demands of the prophet motive. 2. Missionaries may be an extreme case, but the pattern they represent had parallels in other Western occupations. Whether the target resource was gold, farmland, or Indian souls, white Americans went west convinced that their purposes were as commonplace as they were innocent. The pursuit of improved fortunes, the acquisition of property. Even the desire for adventure seemed so self-evident that they needed neither explanation nor justification. If the motives were innocent, episodes of frustration and defeat seemed inexplicable, undeserved, and arbitrary. Squatters defied the boundaries of Indian territory and then were aggrieved to find themselves harassed and attacked by Indians. Similarly, prospectors and miners went where the minerals were, regardless of Indian territorial claims, only to be outraged by threats to their lives and supply lines. Preemptors who traveled ahead of government surveys later complained of insecure land titles. After the Civil War, farmers expanded onto the Great Plains, past the line of semi-aridity, and then felt betrayed when the rains proved inadequate. Western emigrants understood not just that they were taking risks, but also that risks led to rewards. When nature or natives interrupted the progression from risk to reward, the Westerner felt aggrieved. Most telling were the incidents in which a rush of individuals, each pursuing a claim to a limited resource, produced their own collective frustration. In resource rushes, people hoping for exclusive opportunity often arrived to find a crowd already in place, blanketing the region with prior claims, constricting individual opportunity, and producing all the problems of food supply, housing, sanitation, and social order that one would expect in a growing city, but not in a wilderness. If one pursues a valuable item and finds a crowd already assembled, one's complicity in the situation is obvious. The crowd has, after all, resulted from a number of individual choices, very much like one's own. But frustration cuts off reflection on this irony. In resource rushes, in which the sum of the participants' activities created the dilemma, each individual could still feel himself the innocent victim of constricting opportunity. Contrary to all of the West's associations with self-reliance and individual responsibility, misfortune has usually caused white Westerners to cast themselves in the role of the innocent victim. One large group was composed of those who felt injured at the hands of nature. They had trusted nature. And when nature behaved according to its own rules and not theirs, they felt betrayed. The basic plot played itself out with a thousand variations. Miners resented the wasted effort of excavating sites that had looked promising.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.